about what I did on my summer holidays last year. Last summer, my best friend Ella and I got ourselves a vintage ambulance and some doctor's coats, which we borrowed from my mother-in-law without telling her exactly why, and took ourselves to Suffolk and parked in a field in Suffolk, in England. There's Ella, looking for all intents and purposes like a doctor. The field wasn't actually empty. We were at a big music festival in England called Latitude. We opened the doors, put a blackboard outside with appointment times on it, and waited for people to turn up to be our patients. Now, our first patient was a little girl of about 5 who had scraped her knee and really needed a Band-Aid, which actually we had 4 of our own children tucked behind the back of the ambulance, and we were quite adept at dealing with. But after that, we got very sure that we knew how to direct people to the first aid tent where more conventional medicine could be acquired. But our second patient knew exactly what we were providing and wanted to be there. He was a guy of about 40, married with a couple of kids, having a good time at the festival, worked in marketing, I think. We got talking about books, and I tried to establish what his taste in reading was. And he was kind of distracted by something, and I could tell there was something specific on his mind that he wanted to talk about. And he suddenly blurted out, I just really miss that feeling of being transported. You know, when you're a kid and you're reading a book and you're totally swept away and you don't know that time is passing. And I just don't get that anymore. I really miss it. And he had his kids who were having those experiences, and he can't really tell us about what the ambulance wanted to know, whether he'd ever feel that again. So Ella and I have had this conversation with quite a lot of people in the last few years. In 2008, we started prescribing books instead of drugs and set ourselves up as bibliotherapists, as Barbara said, at this rather wonderful educational establishment called the School of Life in London, in Bloomsbury. There it is. It was set up by the philosopher Alain de Botton. And they're fun. They kind of run alternative evening classes on things that you wouldn't get in a normal college. How to get a good work-life balance, how to be a better conversationalist at dinner, how to bring philosophy into your everyday life. So here and in our ambulance, we've seen a lot of clients now who come with emotional issues, you know, all the love ailments that you can imagine. They come having been through some sort of emotional crisis. They may have been bereaved. They may have been diagnosed with an illness of some sort, which they're having to grapple with. They're often at a crossroads, being forced to or choosing to undergo a big change in their lives. Often we get people wanting to change their career and not quite knowing where to start. We had somebody recently, a very interesting one, who had such a strong terror of death that it incapacitated her. She couldn't, her legs would give way beneath her when she tried to walk out the house. So people come to us when they don't know where else to go quite a lot of the time. And we get a lot of people who come now with reading ailments of the sort that I described earlier with the guy that missed being transported. There's some obstacle or some difficulty between themselves and their reading, and they don't know why it is or how to solve it. And I think this is an increasingly common predicament. So Ella and I met at university. We studied English together. So this is going back 20 plus years now. We got into the habit of when one of us was going through any sort of difficult time, of leaving little gifts of novels, a novel outside our bedroom door for each other. And they would normally be fairly harsh prescriptions in those days. We didn't yet call them prescriptions, but there'd be a kick up the backside. You know, there'd be the message of the book would be, stop wallowing, this guy has it much worse than you. And occasionally they were a little bit kinder. The older we got a little bit kinder. You know, don't give up, it's going to be okay, look, this will inspire you. And we discovered, slightly to our surprise, that some of them really worked. For instance, if one of us was having a relationship, a lot of them are about relationships in those days, being 20, if one of us was in a relationship where there was some reason why we really it shouldn't be going ahead, there was a kind of, you know, there was an issue with it that we were very keen to sweep under the carpet, we found that this novel worked wonders. So there's a lovely example of somebody who, you know, wants nothing more than to marry her dark, brooding hero, Mr. Rochester. He's everything that she wanted. She's poor, you know, she's orphaned, she has nowhere else to go. But when she finds that there is actually a very significant obstacle to their marriage, which is, I think I won't be making any spoilers here, because we probably already know that he's already got a wife and a mum upstairs, she walks away. She does something really extraordinary. She walks away. And in doing so, she keeps her self-respect. She's heartbroken, and he's heartbroken, but she keeps her self-respect. And that, of course, makes it possible for, again, apologies for anybody who hasn't read it, the relationship to work in the end. If one of us was feeling a little out of love with life, struggling to get up in the morning, this book works really well for that. Lovely opening, which is full of vigor, breathing in the fresh morning air, you know, getting going off to get her flowers, standing on the pavement all neat and sharp and bird-like, and London rumbling around her. It's really lovely. And if you're going through, I remember one of us was going through an I hate men phase, and we got given this one. And you know what? It didn't work at all. It made whoever it was—I can't remember now—if it's me or Ella—made us hate men even more. So we got better at it. But the interesting thing was, with all these examples, it wasn't explicit. You know, it doesn't say it on the cover what you might get from this book. You had to know. So up until now, the term bibliotherapy, which has been around for about 100 years. Has mainly been used with reference to giving storybooks to troubled kids, kids maybe who have been bullied at school or going through parents separating, you know, the I Have Two Mummies sort of books. And fiction wasn't used for adults in a bibliotherapy sense. And then the self-help book era happened, and bibliotherapy as a term started to be applied to adults, but only with reference to self-help books. And Ella and I felt we really wanted to challenge that. We believed that in fiction, in 2,000 years of literature, we had this extraordinary resource which wasn't really being tapped. Not just because it contains ideas and meditations and experiences from this vast number of people channeled through some of the best minds around through history, not just because this learning is otherwise going to be lost if we don't, it's just going neglected if we don't make use of it, but also because anything that you might be going through right now, anything pretty much, somebody in literature, you can bet, has been there and done that, been through it themselves. So there's something. On this screen, okay, has that message got through up there? I'm going to leave them to do that. Thank you. And there's something more with fiction that we felt was important. It doesn't tell you what to do like self-help books. It shows somebody else dealing with the same issue and then leaves you to draw your own conclusions and decide for yourself what to do. And if anybody has kids, they will know that showing by example, or showing by this example, if that is a word, I'm not sure, is the best way to teach and guide your kids. So some of you will know this book. Probably some people in here have read it. Any show of hands of people who've read it? You're all converted already. It's fantastic. So Feel the Fear and Do It Anyway was a huge seller in England and here. But the only thing I think that people mostly remember from it is just that cover line, feel the fear and do it anyway. Whereas this, lovely, lovely example of somebody who feels the fear and does it anyway. And in a story that will resonate with you forever, you do not forget those moments, do you? When Atticus Finch is walking down the street of Macon to shoot that rabid dog, do you remember that bit? And he puts his hand up with the gun and his hand is shaking. And he gets it right between the eyes. And then, of course, later when he's standing up in defense of the black man accused of raping the white woman, and so sets himself apart from the entire community. So it's interesting to read these books again in this new way, and really allowing the inspiration of those messages to come through to you. And you might like this one too, on the same sort of subject. This is a really wonderful book, less well known. It's written in the style of a 10th century Norse saga, all about Vikings. And that very fragile looking woman on the left is a depiction really of the heroine in there, probably happened the other way around, who is raped at the beginning of the book, and she sets out to exact her revenge. And at one point she's being chased through a forest with her baby. She's a single mum by this time, strapped to her back, with snow on the ground, skis on her feet, wolves howling, and all these bloodthirsty men chasing her through the forest. And she's terrified, and she does the most extraordinary things in her fear. And she only admits to her child at the end of the book, who's then grown up. So we decided it was time to start organising our literary heritage, Ellen and I, and matching ailments to cures. The result was this. This is the American edition. You might see pictures of the English edition, which is orange, so don't get confused. We wanted it to be something which was fun and serious at the same time, so we decided that people should keep it near their medicine cabinet with paracetamol and the Band-Aids. But there is a mixture of serious ailments and more lighthearted ailments in there. Obviously, there's the emotional ones, but we got cocky and decided that if we could cure a broken heart, we could also have a go at, if not curing a broken leg, then we might suggest something which could help. So there are physical ailments in there too, some more serious than others again. I don't know whether you have man flu here, it's very rife in England. This one is for you Americans, really, even more serious, the one on the right. Not being able to find a decent cup of coffee. Some of them we all suffer from time to time. Some of them are much more niche. Chasing after a woman even though she's a nun. Michael and Dutch, you'll notice, cures both these ailments. It's kind of his speciality, that sort of thing. Some things you didn't even know were ailments. Itchy teeth, I discovered some ailments whilst reading through this book. Some things which some of us suffer from more than others. I mean, there's lots of lists in there too. Lists of the 10 best books to drown out somebody snoring, the 10 best books for fear of flying, the 10 best books. Well, this is one of my favourites actually, for somebody who wants to seem well read. If you just read these 10 books, you can quote them at cocktail parties and everybody will be really impressed. You'll notice that they're not all obvious ones. So the art of bibliotherapy, as far as I see it, is to see if you can find somebody the right book at the right time. If you get it right, I think it can be really transformative. So in our caravan, or at the School of Life, I often feel as if I'm at a dating agency. I'm running a dating agency. And first of all, I have to find out somebody's taste in books. Do they like them big? Do they like them slim? Do they like them with a G-S-O-H? How good are they at committing to something which may be a slow burner, may take a little while to get to know, may not be obviously attractive at first? You know, they're going to take these books that you give them on holiday. Some people, my brother, for instance, only reads about 2 books a year. And he takes them on holiday. They make or break his holiday. I have to get that prescription right. They're going to take them to bed with them. You know, you want a book that you want to take to bed. It's got to be right. So my job as a bibliotherapist, I think, is to try and get somebody looking forward to that first date. You want to establish a connection with the book that you're telling them about before they meet. So they have an expectation of a really deep connection, a really lifelong relationship. And if it's a sort of relationship where if the book could give them a wink or the author could give them a wink, they would receive it and know, and they'd say, yeah, and they would talk about that. So most matchmaking between books and readers, actually these days, is done by computer algorithm. If you like this book, you wouldn't say this book. And also, for corporations. Publishing houses are vast corporations these days, with obviously driven by making money. And if you're not careful, your very precious, hard-won reading time, increasingly scarce these days, can be spent on a bit of a merry-go-round with these sort of books at short courses. We're all guilty, you know, and there's nothing wrong with it. In some ways, it's, you know, we all like fast food, it's okay. But how are we going to get from here to this very delightful place? Also a book about religion. I feel my life would be far less rich without this book in it. Or from here, for some people who may not have read a novel since they had to read a novel, this may be the last novel that they've actually read. How are they going to get from here to here? Which is also a book about social etiquette. It's, you know, set in Silicon Valley. It's about the dating game within Silicon Valley. Not that dissimilar to Jane Austen's So, even if you're a very keen reader, you might read, I mean, it's interesting, we can find out later maybe how much people think they read, but you maybe read one book every 3 weeks or so, a novel. Just to make the math simpler, let's say it's one a month, okay, so that's 10 a year. If you think about it in terms of your life, that's not a whole lot of book. I was recently reading Christopher Kimball, the guy who illustrates, who edits Cook's Illustrated, did this calculation based on about one book, however many books this he reads per month. He worked out that he had 72 books left between now and the end of his life. So if you think of it like that, you've got to get it right. So what if there's a book out there which could affect you, whatever age you are, you know, 36, 46, 56, what if there's a book out there, a novel out there, which could affect you as profoundly as did this when you were younger? Or this, maybe. I don't know. I'm gambling here as to what people would have read. Certainly would have read that one. You'd be less cool if you hadn't read that one at the right age, wouldn't you? What should you be reading now to make sure you're still as cool as you are now in 10 years' time? So the question is how to find that book, the transformative book. And of all reasons to read, you know, we read for the story, we read to learn about human beings, about life, we read for the love of the language, the enjoyment of the language. I would say that being transported is most likely to lead to transformation, what the guy at the beginning was asking to feel again. So I've become very interested in the subject of transportation, sorry. What is going on in our brains when we are transported? Now, I happen to be married to a neuroscientist, which comes in very handy at moments like this. I was imagining, conveniently, that if you were to do an MRI scan of my brain in a normal busy day when I was running around being distracted and it was all active and lights going off everywhere, and then when I was reading, I'm not normal, and I was transported, there would be a lovely, calm focus about the MRI scan. Just be very little going on because I'm calm and relaxed and focused. It's as close to meditation as I get. And I'm not out there, I'm in here. I'm in here. And as often happens when I ask the question like this, I get the opposite answer to the one I really want. He said actually, when you're reading, there's a flurry of activity in the brain, it's a very busy picture. He also started spouting lots of jargon, oculomotor control, symbolic decoding, semantic activation, physio-lexical fluency, and these are familiar words to me, actually, but I often when he starts spouting these words, I realize that actually he has no idea what happens in the brain when I'm reading. But then I started to understand something of what he was saying. He was basically saying, and you have to bear with me here, that seeing language on the page, it's very similar in terms of what's going on in the brain activity, to hearing language. So the narrative of the story becomes a heard voice inside your head, okay? That's point one. Second, when hearing something, another person, all this internal hearing, the internal monologue, which is our thoughts, basically stops. It gets displaced. And if we're hearing very intently, it stops completely. The hearing takes over. So, in other words, the reading voice, what you're reading, replaces your internal monologue, which I take to mean you kind of cease to be. You become the story instead. But I found this very exciting. It explained to me what being transported was. We're not in our own life anymore. We're in the life of this story. And another thing, more interesting still, so contemporary neuroscience, and you'll have heard this in the last few years, has been saying that thinking about doing something, again, is very similar in terms of brain activity as doing something. So they often give the example of the 20 jumping jacks. If you think about doing 20 jumping jacks, the activity patterns in your brain are really not that dissimilar to if you were doing the jumping jacks yourself. So I started thinking that reading, therefore, thing, what we're hearing, what we're thinking, is also similar to doing, as far as our brains are concerned. So a character that eats a mango, fires a gun, weeps, climbs a hill, slips on ice, has a child, turns into a swan, I don't know, befriends a penguin, as far as the brain is concerned, we're kind of doing those things too. And if a writer knows how to describe really, really well, I started to ask myself, could it be that this experience of this thing is more vivid than if we were living it ourselves? So if we read about somebody going for a walk, for instance, in this book you may have heard of, it's about somebody who's obsessed with walking. Is that better than going, if I go for a walk myself, if I walk down to the local shop at the corner of my street, I am going for a walk, but I'm actually thinking about what I'm going to buy to cook for supper. And could it be that reading about an amazing party on Long Island in the 20s, you know where I'm going, with the laughter, the clinking of the glasses, the lights, the water, the music, all described by a maestro, all those beautiful shirts stacked up, do you remember all that? Is that better, possibly, than being at the party ourselves? What is clear is that reading is not just a representation of experience, it is an alternative form of experience. It gives that little aphorism, some of you may have heard it before, it gives a little bit more meaning, right? So transformational novels have something in common. They conjure things really vividly. We get transported by them because our stimuli, the stimuli in the here and now, is replaced with their stimuli. I'm talking about the senses here. So when I'm not being a bibliotherapist, I'm being a novelist, I've written two novels, and I'm being a teacher of creative writing. And at the core of writing and teaching writing is this adage, which I'm sure will be familiar to many of you, of show, not tell. When you're writing, you need to show, not tell. So in a minute, I'm going to read an excerpt from a book which I love, which shows how showing can work really well. It's an exercise I use with beginning students, and it really changes their writing overnight. It's very exciting. The story is about a boy who loves to ride. This is the book. He wants to be a jockey. He's Australian. And his mother dies. He's got a father who's abusive to him. And at the age of 18, he gets out and he manages to get himself a passage to America on a boat looking after a racehorse. And so he travels with his racehorse to where it's being sold in America. And he becomes stablehand to the guy who owns the racehorse. And the boss, Shackleton, is a difficult character, but it's the boss's wife who is even more difficult. And the saving grace of this place is that he meets somebody there, a girl from Cali, who he falls in love with. Now, some of you may have just noticed that I just told that story. I pre-seed it, right? Did anyone get a picture in their heads of anything? I hope you don't. Anybody transported? Okay, well, we can compare. So this is the real thing. I'm just going to read to you now, so please sit back and enjoy this bit. It's going to be read to you like a child. On Fridays, Shackleton's wife, Rosemary, storms the garden, a glass of red wine in one hand and a cigarette ringed with lipstick in the other. One time in June, she had me help her, cutting stems of flowers in bloom, roses, lilacs,
narcissus. She was most enthusiastic, teaching me their names, dahlias, daphnes, daffodils. She arranged them with Queen Anne's lace and lavish painted vases, had me place them up on tables and antique pedestals around the downstairs rooms, ready for when she'd take her husband out of the station. She said she liked listening to my accent. "How old are you?" she asked me in the garden, her cashmere breast against my forearm as she leant to smell the lilacs. I wasn't sure if I should move or stay to meet the brush of her body. 18, I told her. Her scent was of perfumes and powder, smoke. "Got me some of those," she said. "Their season is so short, I hate to see them go." She was either from England or sounded like it. She had corn blonde hair, not unlike my mother's. Her laugh rang around me like an echo. I was nervous with her on my own, the way she was with the bottle around. "I'm 36, she said. I acted like I was surprised. "Don't we have enough flowers?" I asked her. "Years," she said, mimicking the way I talked. "I don't sound like that," I said. She took a sip from her glass, added to the lipstick prints. "You and that little calliope coats running around the garden like farts in a bath. Probably has you prowling around the country with that negro groom of hers." I wondered if she'd seen Callie naked by the pool. "She's got tickets on herself, funny little thing. Feet so small she's plucky to be out on them. Ankles you could snap with your hands." "Callie's so good she could go to the Olympics," I told her. "I have tickets on her too." "Good for her." "So did you get things in your head that time, pictures in your head?" See some nods. So you saw things, right? I don't know whether you noticed any other senses. If we go back, if we, Shackleton's wife, Rosemary, storms the garden, a glass of red wine in one hand, a cigarette ringed with lipstick in the other, so we see her, we know exactly what she looks like. She was most enthusiastic, teaching me their names. We start to hear her. She said she liked listening to my accent. "How old are you?" And then we feel her cashmere breast against my forearm. I wasn't sure if I should move or stay. So we feel him feeling her. And then in the dialogue, we've got some lovely, lovely subtext. This is the key to brilliant dialogue. "I'm 36, she said. "Now, what does she mean then? She's not telling him she's 36 to tell him she's 36, you know? What is she saying? She's saying, I'm not that old, really. She's saying, I've got lots of experience. Is she saying, let's just get my age out of the way, shall we, so you don't have to mention it again? And he's going, I acted like I was surprised. So what's he really thinking there? Thinking, that's pretty old. He's thinking, got to pretend that's really young, and actually she looks really young, younger than that. He's thinking, mustn't be rude, mustn't lose my job. You know, there's all this stuff going on which isn't told, it's shown. So much more is going on than the words on the page. There's what happened, and there's an explanation of what happened. And it's the author who is guiding us as to how to respond, how to feel about these events. So in life, we just have what happened. We don't have anybody with us saying, oh, that's what's going on there, isn't it? So it's that relationship that I was talking of at the beginning, that space between author and reader, in which you can share this intimacy, of this shared understanding of the moment. I like to think of it as a place of a shared we. There's the author going, you know, you see that, and the reader's going, yeah, they get it. So they recognize something, they get something. And actually, Harold Bloom has talked about what I believe to be this moment. He talks about it as that one nature that reads and writes. So, in a sense, the writer and the reader collide in that space. And there are probably other writers here. I've certainly experienced it as a novelist when I'm writing something. If I manage to really capture something, a moment, and I'm really, you know, I feel as if I've really captured it, I'm anticipating the reception of my wink that I'm sending out, if you like, into the ether, across time and space to some as yet imaginary reader to receive. You know, and it's a lovely moment for a writer to experience so that they know that it will be received at some time. So this space of the wink is a space of the unsayable. It's a space where things, where It's characterized by contradictions, often an ambiguity, things which are really hard to spell out. It's very often a place of irony. So the reader understands what's going on, the author obviously understands what's going on, but the characters do not quite understand what's going on. Often it's a space of humor as well because of that. It's very important that the space of the wink is dealing with something very human, something perhaps quite subtle, which we recognize. So in the piece from Agapantha's Tango, it's the older, experienced person, the younger, vulnerable person. You know, we recognize that dynamic, maybe with the genders reversed or whatever. You know, there's something there that's recognizable from our own minds. Do you remember this book? That is a book that's full of these moments, and one of them is on the cover there. Do you remember the liver and rutabaga moment where the boy is forced to finish what's on his plate? Those of us of a certain generation have been there. His experience is worse than ours, actually. It's 50 times worse than ours. He's there for almost the rest of the day, I seem to remember. So these moments, when they're captured in novels, are very often a distillation of experience. It's a perfect moment. A really concentrated moment compared to all of our imperfect moments of the same thing. But when we read it, we feel heard and understood, and we feel exonerated. We feel as if somebody's finally understood this thing which we've never quite put into words ourselves. We feel we're not alone. So literature then exposes us to a wide variety of experiences. We can live other lives than our own, and often more intensely than we might be able to experience something ourselves. It may be that something we can never experience. We can never be an 18-year-old boy if we're a woman. And it does this by our minds more original than our own. At the same time, it does the opposite. It reassures us we're not alone. So even within there, there's a contradiction. There's something fundamentally human about us all. It is like falling in love. The dating agency thing works, you know. You can't quite believe that you've met this book that says this thing that you always knew, you know. And always like sex, you can't quite believe it's happening right now. There's an ecstasy there, there's a relief there, this feeling of not being alone. So, recommending is not about trying to improve somebody. It's not about showing off. It's not an egotistical thing. The chemical reaction that happens between one reader and the author in the space of this book and another reader and the same book will be different because we all bring different stuff to that book. We've had different life experiences. I like to see this process of recommending as something very tame. If the internet is a place of printing, it's the tweet about this great piece that we read in the New Yorker. It's Facebook, it's look what I did. It's saying, look at that, look what I've seen, look what I was clever enough to have noticed. So it's not only a pointing place, but it's a slightly gloating place. There's a gloat implicit in every point. The space of the shared wink, conversely, it's not about writing. It's a very, very intimate place. It's always one-to-one. So even when we're reading in the company of somebody else, it's a place of one-to-one intensity with the author. It's a place of intellectual equality. It's a place of emotional vulnerability, if it's a good book. It's a place in which to experience those moments which don't get talked about very much in everyday life. So, I would like to go as far as saying, with a book that is really, which shows beautifully, which is like life but only better, it makes you think that reading and writing, for me, the two are indistinguishable, is about the best thing you can do with your time. And recommending a transformative book to somebody is certainly the best thing you can do for another person. Wouldn't you like to put somebody you love in this space? And isn't that nice? And certainly the books want to be put in that space. That's what happens when you don't put a book in that space. So I only only moved to New Haven 18 months ago, but I've already seen some really lovely examples of people spreading book love in New Haven. You might recognize that yellow book bank from East Rock Park. That's my son helping himself to a probably inappropriate book. Above him, one of New Haven's finest, with his portmanteau library on the corner of Kenner and Anderson. You can get pick up a free book there. And the other photograph is outside a house, a guy's house in Manila in the Philippines. And this guy decided that he was going to move all his books out of his house and onto the sidewalk so that other people could read them. And it's turned massive, apparently. It's just this huge free library where you just trust it to bring it back. So I'd like to start to draw to a close by passing on some of the books that I have found to be transformative in my life. So during the writing of The Novel Cure, you know those lists of the 10 most stressful things you can go through that you're always finding on the internet? Well, I went through about 6 of them in the 2 or 3 years that I was writing The Novel Cure. I moved house and actually moved country as well. I got married. My father died. Ella, my co-author, her mother died. So we were going through all this stuff, and we were really putting the novels we were reading to the test. They were, I can honestly say, they were even more of a sort of a support system than I could possibly have imagined them being. It was kind of amazing what happened. This one, with anybody familiar with this writer. This book showed me the importance of maintaining your friendships above all else. So I was working on this project with my best friend, which can be challenging. It was challenging for both of us at times. This one, we kept reminding ourselves of this one. This is a really amazing book for how to remind yourself how to become unselfish. I have to be reading this one. We all have to be reading this one. A beautiful showing of selflessness. This one, actually, to remind oneself how important it is to be kind to everybody that you might meet, every stranger that you might meet, because you never know what it is they may have gone through, maybe going through. This one, amazing book. It's possible to go through the deepest grief and smile again. It's a very useful book for bibliotherapists. This one, I can only say this because I'm in America. The message is, for me, if you've got love, you can cope with everything. So we you might be surprised to see this one, but we do prescribe children's books for adults too. Be grateful for every little essential thing. Well, you know this book, you know, Live with Lightness, a wonderful novel for helping you to live with lightness even when times are hard, especially when times are hard. This is the one that reminds me that it's okay to have intimate relationships with books. And this one, that it's really good to reread, because I was rereading a lot for this project, and wow, does Tolstoy get better with age? Very exciting. That bringing energy and saying yes is the best gift you can give to your friends. Do whatever you do with obsession and passion. I hope it doesn't kill you. As we try to do in our work. So, I'd like to leave you with this thought. Recommending a novel is almost as good as having written it. Because a book is useless if it doesn't have a reader, right? It might as well not have been written. And it's a whole lot easier than writing a book. We find it hard to find time to read these days. It's a very common output that we get brought to us. But it is possible to prioritize and to find that time if we really, really want to. Here's a picture of my husband doing that
on a high-speed train out of London, keeping our then four-month-old son safe, as you can see. You can see where his priorities were. If you find it hard to find time to read because it feels selfish, it feels like you're doing something for yourself, why not think of it this way? Read so that you can recommend, so that you can give the gift of recommending something else.